everybody up there, caffeine ingestion, everybody high on caffeine.
Great, good.
Well, I want to introduce you.
I want to introduce you to someone who's not been a friend for too long for me. In fact, I've just met him this evening. I've just spent about 10 minutes chasing him around Wakefield trying to find him. But it's good to have with us this evening, Jason Barney. Let's give him natural bodybuilding champion, and I think that deserves another champion. So Jason, just tell us, how long have you actually been the world champion?
I've been the world champion only, I'm loud enough with all that. Yeah. So do you not hear me? That's why you get a shout at the kids in kids' church. Right, I've been world champion since 2008, so it took me quite a long time to win that title. I've been training 29 years now. Been training since I was 11, and I've been competing since so far 22 years. So it was a long road to win the world championship, really.
Wow, that's brilliant. So, and how many competitors did you have to beat to get your championship?
You're talking on stage at 10, but it's probably the only sport where you don't get a true number on stage, because what happens is at the start of the year, you'll get 100 people that say they're going to compete, and because there's not a lot you can do in the last week or on the day, you've got an idea whether you're going to do well on that day or not. So basically people will not compete if things aren't going well. So unlike football, where if Peru have had poor preparation for the World Cup, they'll still go and get beat by Brazil 10-0. If a guy knows he's going to get beat, basically he won't be there. So what we said is, we should make all the people that said we're going to do it at the beginning of the year come on stage anyway and just shake your hand, and then rather than you could literally end up with being so good that you could end up being the only one in the class, because people would say it's kind of no point me turning up. And right. So right. But I think there were 12 in the class, and I was the youngest at 37.
Not for me yet then, eh? So, you said you've been bodybuilding for 29 years. How long was it that you were in preparation for the actual championship competition?
You're talking, really, your prep can be like 4 months to half a year, where we call it kind of going in the hole, which is cardio twice a day, sometimes three times a day, which is the way I prefer to do it. So an hour in the morning, sometimes in the middle of the night I'll do it, and then an hour before bed. That's just the cardio, which is exercise, bike, and then your weight training. You've got presentation practice, you're weighing all your food and stuff. So it is very all consuming, so you really do have to find another reason to drive you just than getting on stage when it takes away so much from your life.
So you do it in the middle of the night, does that mean you have to get out of bed and do it?
Sometimes it's just, again, it's sometimes I kind of try and get a balance of how I do things. So where people would say do it at 7 o'clock in the morning or 12 o'clock at night or 7 in the evening, if I've got an event or something to prepare for, and I'd rather go to sleep at that time, and it makes sense to just, because I'm tired, go to sleep, and I naturally wake up at 3 in the morning, I may go to sleep at 8, wake up at 3, do the cardio then and go back to bed. So rather than fighting myself and doing it at specific times, I'll make sure I get what I need to do, but keep that balance of being healthy and being able to fulfil the rest of the tasks and things I've got to do.
Brilliant. So is that sort of, that's your preparation for the actual competition?
Yeah.
So now that you're actually the champion, what sort of regime do you have to follow in order to maintain your championship level? Same sort of thing?
Yeah, it's the same thing, it's a consistent. Natural bodybuilding, like I say, do they know the difference? Well, does everyone know the difference?
That was a question.
Okay, natural bodybuilding, it's the only sport bodybuilding where you've got a choice. You can either compete tested or non-tested. That would basically mean, so as a group, people have decided it was intended to be healthy, about being stronger, about being balanced in your mind and your life, and so they started a federation where there was full testing. Now, because it's something that takes place over a long period, over time, you can't assert them with a drug test that someone hasn't done something for 10, 15 years and then just come off the test for a year or for the competition. So we all have to do a polygraph test, which is a lie detector test, to make sure that we've never ever taken drugs in our lives. So in terms of the differences, at 5'6", or in that, anyone want to have a guess at my weight in that picture?
Well, I know.
Even though it's like, you hold on then. You hold on. Anyone want to have a guess? 12, we're going 12. Any advance?
We've got 13-9.
13-9 you're going with. I am, at the weigh-in, I was 9 stone 13. 9 stone 13. So I'm about 10 stone 8 now. So the difference is coming down, but someone my height without, on who's not tested, maybe 14, 15 stone. So the little guys that you see, like tanks, that can be the big difference. So,
so you're founder and director of Supernatural Fitness, is that right? Just talk to us for a while about what Supernatural Fitness does and its aims and what a day in the life of the Supernatural Fitness Director means.
Yeah, I've worked in education for 15 years in special education, kids with behavioural problems, and there was always an attraction to the bodybuilding side, and that gave me a way of speaking to some of the kids that are well off the rails, and certainly getting respect of some of the older kids, sports people, sportsmen. So through Supernatural Fitness, it's kind of got three meanings. It's like the supernatural, so my spiritual side. I've always been known as Supernatural because being a natural athlete, and then I've always been a little superheroes and Batman and all that stuff. So it was like the perfect name that encompassed all these four things. And then the fitness side, so it was basically, we work with professional athletes, with the kids, with players, and what I try and do is kind of get, teach them the health and fitness side, but again, it's the kind of spiritual side and the mindset. The players, and all of them are big kids, a lot of them have left home early, away from home, so it's kind of giving them and explaining to them their gift, and talking to them about their purpose and how they're role models for some of the kids. So I not only go in and teach them about fitness, but sit down, kind of shoot the breeze with them, these same sort of conversations, and speak to them about what they're going to do with their lives and how they're going to kind of affect sort of the next generation. So it's really my role with Supernatural Fitness is to speak to as many people as possible and kind of inspire them to fulfill their potential. So telling my whole journey of being the smallest kid in school, becoming a world champion, leaving home at 15, becoming a world champion bodybuilder, and then sort of fulfilling my goals, really, and saying to them that you can inspire everybody to do that. I believe God's got like a purpose for everybody to do something amazing with their lives, and mine was kind of, it's been up and down and a mess kind of all along, and mine is just totally transformed. I couldn't have done all about it, and every time I look around and I see people not fulfilling their potential, I know, look, if God's kind of doing that for me, it's well within you, and there's only certain changes you've got to make in your life for him to kind of grab hold of everything and turn it around. So I get a real kind of buzz and excitement about even coming here when you know there's people, and you know you're going to get that chance to just say to people, right, come on, grab a hold of something, be a warrior, be a soldier, and go out for what you want to do with your life.
Brilliant, Jason. So, and I also understand that you work with professional rugby clubs and football clubs. Who would they sort of be? Who have you worked with?
Fortunately, I live in Bradford, so... Don't take the blame for a current predicament. But I do the nutrition with Bradford City and the Bulls, and basically go in, do them their diets at the beginning of the year, and if I can, for some of them, I'll go and do it with the families as well. Because for a lot of the players, the coach is telling them they need to slim down, they're coming into the club and eating what they want, but then especially for the Fijian guys and the Samoans, they get home and their wives are like, eat, eat, eat. So it's getting into the families, educating them. Again, if you can educate them so the kids are not got chocolate smothered all over the place and it's easier on the place. It's a whole family thing of letting them understand what that's about.
That's brilliant. Good. Okay. So you've touched on it a little bit already, but just talk to us for a while now on how you got into bodybuilding.
Do you want the full story, the juice? Do you want the juice? Yeah. The door's shut, there's no further than this room, although I've told it about 50 rooms, or many rooms, so everyone does. Right, when I was probably like, 9, 10 growing up, so me and my brother were the only black kids in our school, so there was a lot of kind of racism and stuff, and in terms of girls, that wasn't really seen as an option for me and my brother. And so, I just remember one day in drama class, the teacher asked us to kind of do a warm-up, just to be like an elephant, and neck like a tree, and then for some random reason, thank you God, she asked us to do press-ups as a warm-up. So all these, like, we've been out 11, all these 11-year-old boys jumped down to do these press-ups, and I stood watching them, and when 11-year-old boys try and do press-ups, it just looks like they're trying to do something rude to the carpet. Instead, I jumped down, and I bangs out 12 perfect press-ups. girl's like, Jason, can you feel your muscles? Jason, you're so strong. So I hatched a plan. And I went home. And every single night from then on, I did press-ups. It was the same. We never ever did them again. In that, I found something that I could always excel at, always get better at. It was a case of if I did 13 one day and I tried the next day and I failed and got 12, then it didn't matter. I tried again. And I found something that no one could tell you were a failure at. My teachers told me I was a clown, I was loud, I was messing things up. Now and again, you get that from your parents when they're frustrated with you. And you start to think, there's nothing that I can do. There's nothing I can't do without failing. And this one thing that I found was, I can try and get stronger every day. I can try to attempt something and always give it my best, and no one ever says it's not good enough. So that was my big passion for that. And then finding that I'm really good at something just drove me to take it to this level. It's about the fact that I'm the best at it. It's not always like, it doesn't make a lot of sense to me sometimes, looking at them, standing on stage in your underpants and that. But it's something that I'm gifted at. It has that influence, and you know, you wake up every day with a purpose. People will say it's all consuming, but that's what makes it have that power in life, because there's nothing that you don't do that doesn't help you. Not getting stressed helps you grow better. Relaxing, not getting into arguments. Everything you do, even in terms of just sleeping well, being healthy, making sure you don't get colds, making sure you look after yourself, it all has a build towards this. Brilliant. So it means there's never a day when you get up and you think, what am I doing today? What's the point of life? It's always like, I can do something towards being the best in the world.
Brilliant. So, that's a brilliant thing. So I understand you belong to a church as well now. Just tell me, what's a world champion bodybuilder doing belonging to a church, or going to church?
Going to church. I worked on the door. I was brought up in church, so my mum, we went to church when we were little. Kind of, I was on the choir. Can I bring my brother as well? Because me and my brother used to punch the living daylights out of each other. We'd go to the thing with Jenny Flack banging in the ribs. We'd sit in the service. We'd tap and it'd get more violent, violent. By the time we went out and Jenny flexed to Jesus and then got in the back room, we were bang, bang, bang. So I know you don't want us in the choir. But yeah. I kind of been brought up, and I always knew God was there. No one ever really had to tell me it wasn't. I just remember every time I got in trouble, if it were really, really serious, if it weren't too bad, I was willing to take a hiding from my parents. But if it were really, really bad, it's time to do a deal with God. Just please, 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 God, if you get me out of this, I'll never do it again. And I always kind of did that talk properly. I knew I was talking to God. I don't think anyone ever told me about it or said, this is what you believe. It was just an instinct as a child that was in me from when I grew up. And I'd left home at 15, because again, people not understand what I wanted to do and the vision kind of that I had. Ended up getting involved in gangs at sort of like 17, 18, and kind of, again, trying to belong to like this family that you guys have got going on. That was my thing, to try and belong with a family. So got involved in them, working on the doors and stuff, and it got to the point where I was working on a door, ended up with there being a guy coming with a gun, there was an attempted murder, and this one, yeah, I'll tell this one, because what happened was, is a guy had said he was basically going to come back. He'd had an issue with somebody else. He was going to come back and shoot me. And he'd been earlier on in the year, he'd brought a machete, stuck by the door, there was all sorts. And we sort of said to the police, this guy's coming back. They'd ignored it, and the guy had come back, and what he must have done was parked on the other side of the road. And he would have had to go around the roundabout to come round to do whatever he felt he was going to do. And I believe that night that God saved my life, because somebody was leaving. And they were taking a boat, and he was a little old, well not old, but a guy who was drunk. And as he's going, I said, oh, you can't take your bottle with you, I'm sorry. And he said, what? And I said, oh, your bottle, you can't take it with you. He went, what? I went, it don't matter, your bottle, you can't take it with you. And I took it off him, and I went and put it on the table there. And as I turned round, everybody was coming the other way when they're supposed to be leaving. And what had happened was, he'd stood there, seen me stood outside the door, kind of got ready, decided he was going to drive around and do his thing. And in that time, while he was going around the roundabout, I believe God sent this guy. I was out the way. When he got there, he literally just shot at the floor and drove off. And he kind of got done for attempted murder on four people. But from that, there were other incidences where I kept staying in the wrong places. Don't think I was supposed to be on the door, but staying and working in those places and really trying to swim upstream, because I had this heart, I was already working in school then, and I think I was, no, not quite going back to church, but the heart of God was in me, that all the things I saw didn't fit with who I was as a person. So I was always trying to, should be doing this, you should be doing that. I was kind of the goody-goody on the door, so I got a lot of backs up, kind of swimming upstream and stepping out where others were saying, no, this is how it is around here. And I'm saying, no, I don't feel that. It's not supposed to be like this. If people have come out to have a good time, we should still be doing the right things, you know, people should still be doing legal things. So I'm fighting against this, which brought the backs up. So there was a shooting, there was that, because someone took me to a bathroom and smashed my face with a knuckle duster. My face has collapsed on that side. And eventually when that one went, I said, I don't like the way the world feels. I don't like the way I get up each day. And it doesn't feel like it's supposed to. And I kind of asked myself the question, well, what's it supposed to feel like? And I thought, I'm not sure, but I remember what it felt like when I was little. I remember what it felt like when I was in trouble. And I wonder if that's just a child thing. I wonder if it's real. And the day after that, I said, I'm going to find a church. And I drove around. I went to the Abundant Life and I said to Gary Stebbs, can anybody come in? He said, yeah. Went in the steps, and that feeling that they say that literally as I walked through the doors, I was kind of very skeptical, man. I'm like, yeah, it's the same feeling. I'm home. And then that was it. That was it. And it was like, this is where I'm supposed to be now. This is where I'm supposed to be. If I go in a club or anywhere where I used to work and was comfortable, it's just horrible. I've been out on New Year's Eve and I've nothing against it totally. I've gone out freely, but I have a good night. Gone out New Year's Eve, maybe been in there 5-10 minutes, and looked at my brother and said, should go home. Just, I can't be in those places anymore. Just something has changed in me, and something changed in me over that time that said, what you felt like when you were little, that's what life's supposed to be like. You need to find something within that that connects to this, that connects to what you're doing, but has this feel behind it, that has this power behind it. And the day I walked back into church, that's where I feel that power came back.
That's brilliant. And would you say that was you knowing Christ and receiving Christ into your life and experiencing it again yourself?
Yeah, because it was done for me. We'd heard Bible stories, I'd heard things about that, still growing up in the choir, I'd heard all these stories, but it was never really taught to us with any kind of power. Me, that's me now growing up as a warrior. That's kind of my thing. So when I went to church and people started talking about, no, Jesus is real, you're supposed to, he's here and he died so that you can have this power, so that you can use it in your life, I thought, this makes sense. I always do a common sense approach with everything. And that story of, okay, God made me, God's my dad, we were messing up, so God decided, with that almost ignorant really, he's going to have to come in human form to show us kind of how it's done. And I thought, I like that. So this man came, did it all, said, right, now I've showed you, I'm going, I'm leaving you, but I'm going to leave you with a little bit of power to do it all, and all you've got to do is believe that's what I've left for you. And me kind of accepting, okay, right, Jesus, you're going to be on my side, I'm going to get the power, and kind of accepting that has just made me so much more powerful in everything I do. When I come here now, I'd have to think about what I'm going to say to you guys. I don't have to think about what I'm going to say if I see you guys in the street that I need to speak to. I just know that God's power works through me. And it's when you're just totally sure about something and it's totally, totally real, then that's when it becomes amazing. Because of who I am, it would be something if it wasn't real. I'd be very worried about going out and speaking about something that wasn't real. But I can know, even with the respect I've got in the bodybuilding community, with the reputation I've got to keep, I can say exactly what I know to be true. Because no matter what people say to me about, you've got it wrong, maybe there is no God, maybe this is all a mistake, I know, because it's the truth, one day God's going to hit you with it. I know there's never a person I've ever spoken to, I don't care if they're atheist, whatever, I know there's not a single person on the planet I've ever spoken to that's never stood in a room on their own and said, right then God, what's this all about? Even if it's an argument. So I know that resonates. There's no one on the planet, I don't think, that's not had a conversation with God, even if it's to tell him that he's a fool. I remember doing that when I was little. I don't believe in God. Oops, sorry. No, I'm not sorry. I don't believe in God. And they're just confused. But God is there. God is real.
Great. That's great, Jason. I'm just going to ask you one more question. Yeah. And it's this. What would you say, I'll ask you, what's the most important
thing to you, being the world natural bodybuilding champion, or knowing Jesus as your saviour? What's the most important to you?
Knowing Jesus as my saviour.
Excellent.
But with that, what happens is I definitely went to God one day and I'm like, okay, well, this all feels a bit like me, and now that I've kind of fallen in love with you, I'm ready to do what you want me to do. Because again, my gift is with the kids and stuff. So if you want me to do kids church, I'll do kids church. Literally, I was like, I'll give this up because I've done the British Championship, won all that. I'll do kids church. I literally remember the week after, there must have been like 5-6 situations where if I wasn't a bodybuilder, it wouldn't have the same effect. Literally, kids up trees, shouting, we won't get down, throwing stones. And it's, oh, you brought the bouncer, have you? Show us your muscles, make me dad trains. Then it was down the tree. There were gangs that had gone out to and got out of the car, and it was like, oh, you train me? Conversations, and I'm like, this is. And it was almost, as soon as I said to God, right, you can have it now, He's given it back. And within the community now, from the amount of bodybuilders and guys and professional athletes that say, give me phone calls and say, we know you talk about your faith. Can I just have a word? I had this feeling when I was little. So it's they say when you, so many conversations I'm having the last few weeks, I don't know if this is for anyone in here, is people are saying, I love what you've got, Jay. It looks really, really good, you know what? But I don't want to give up this, and I don't want to give up that. And how have you managed to get like that? And Jesus said this really clear. He said, if you try and save your life, you're going to lose it. But if you give it up, you'll find it. And it's really hard to understand until you do it. And me saying, you can have the bodybuilding stuff and give it away. And then suddenly, everybody, even like this, saying, because you're a bodybuilder, we want you to come and teach Jesus through that. And now it's got that power, now it's got a purpose. Because at the end of the day, to do it and get this that sits on a shelf, it's like, well, do I get another one and another one? Well, then to train in a gym, knowing that every rep that you do, every meal that you eat, can save somebody's life and save them for eternal life and send them to heaven. It's like, it's the people that are training and playing football for dollars and for pounds, and I'm accumulating lives, and I know how real it is. I don't know how to stress that any more than you could offer to take my life now, and I would never ever say that it's not real and go against that, because I know it's to be true. There's no fear now in my life. No fear about anything whatsoever.
Wonderful.
Wonderful. Okay. It's been great to have you here this evening, Jess. It's a pity we've got to stop now, but I'd like to talk to you further. I do know that you do, I was looking on your website this afternoon, and I noticed that you do one-to-one sessions, don't you?
I do, but I'll tell you what, more than that, there's Phoebe, I've got these cards, and in fact, if you've got your iPhones with you now, it's a YouTube channel, and every week I do little comedy videos on there on health and fitness, so it's for everybody. It's just for, you know, if you're at work, if you've got kids and you can't get your meals in, or you know when to catch colds and stuff, there's a bit of everything. So it's Coach Jason Barnett on YouTube, so you can take a card. And really, through that library, it's going to be a way of me kind of reaching everybody and everybody getting that information for free. Can I do one last thing? Because I have a friend called John Edwards, he's a big inspiration. And I never normally do this, but he's messaged me today and said, I've got to pray for anyone that's sick. And I'm like, that's not my thing that I normally do. I will pray for someone to be encouraged, because it's easy to say to someone, right, I'm praying you be encouraged, and you're going to have a great week. Because then I can just walk up and say, right, well, if they don't do it, that's their fault.
Well, shall we do it this way, Jess? Yeah. What we'll say is, anybody who's sick here this evening and you'd like Jason to pray for you, come and talk to him at the end of the meeting, and he'll pray with you.
Yeah, okay? Definitely. So if there's something that's, just in terms of your health and fitness, if there's something that, I know I've never hardly been sick, I've had 2 colds in 20 years, I've had like one sort of fluid type illness where I was like, I don't know, people cope. It was like a man flu, because I've never had it. And I'm like, how do people carry on? How do you just like... So if you ever feel like that, you can't do what you're supposed to do. So whatever gift you've got in you, if you're feeling ill and you're fed up with being sick and stuff, I'm just kind of saying that I'm praying that you get better and you start feeling better. Because I know just for the fact that you've been here and just from the smiles on your faces, you've all got good hearts. You're here to kind of to help other people. And I'm praying that if you can be well and you can all be fit and healthy, then you can go out and do your purpose, you can affect people. And if people see you guys fit and healthy and realise, well, these guys have got something special, they're going to be a lot more interested in what you guys have got to say. So that's the prayer done, really. So.
But if you do want him to pray with you individually, then at the end of our time this evening, come and say yes. And he'll be down here at the front, he'll be hanging around, and you'll be more than willing
to. Yeah, I think we've got a pen, so I can sign some of these as well.
Excellent. Ladies and gentlemen, Jason Barnett.